Good morning, everybody. It's lovely to see you, and it's so good to have the Sunday school back in the building. It's really exciting. You do feel that we're moving forward, and we're also now at 1 meter distance, so you don't even have to book to come to church anymore. So how good is that, that we have enough space for everybody? So I'm going to ask everybody on Zoom, if they've not muted, to mute, and for Debbie to unmute and lead us with our invocation.
Christ be beside me, Christ be before me, Christ be behind me, King of my heart. Christ be within me, Christ be below me, Christ be above me, never to part. Christ on my right hand, Christ on my left hand, Christ all around me, shield in the strife. Christ in my sleeping, Christ in my sitting, Christ in my rising, light of my life. Christ be in all hearts, thinking about me. Christ be in all tongues, telling of me. Christ be the vision in eyes that see me, in ears that hear me, Christ ever be.
Thank you, Debbie, for that. Come to listen, to learn, and to then go and tell the good news of Jesus as we worship together in the name of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so we're going to come to our first worship song, and it is Baptized in Water from CH4, number 636. Baptized in Water, and you can stand to sing.
Baptized, Lord Christ, your righteous grace brings my undone love, Christ of me. Grace of salvation, trusting his promise, faithfully now, Lord, grace be still.
So I think this is probably as far as I'm allowed to come at the moment, but how's everybody? Good. You had a good week at school? No. Oh dear. Is it not nice to be back? No? Okay. But meeting your friends would be good. No? Oh, I don't think so. I think you're just teasing me. I think you've got lots of good friends at school that you've been really chuffed to see. But today we're going to think about, we're going to talk about mission later on, but we're sharing news. And how do we share news? So we've got the first slide. How many people have used a telephone like that? No? Never used one like that? I don't even think, oh, we've got a hand up. I was going to say, I don't even think folk here will have used a telephone like that, but there is one hand up. So that's how, when the telephones first came out, then they looked very different to how they are today. So we'll have the next slide. What about that one? That's more familiar, isn't it? I can remember being really excited when we first got a telephone and it looked like that and dialing the numbers. What about the next one? Yeah, and I thought we were really posh when we got one like that, because looking on the American films in the 70s, they all seemed to have digital telephones, whereas we had, you had to put your finger in and dial round. So I thought you were really smart when you got a phone like that. Now, what about the next one? Who's had a mobile like that? It's like a Nokia. But you see, when they first came out, they were really big and clunky. Next one. What about that? Yeah. Yeah, that's getting more modern, isn't it? That's getting a bit more modern. And what about the next one? There we are. Is that familiar to everybody? Is it old still? Now, you see, these are the ones I don't know what to do with. A phone used to be a phone. Now you can do all sorts of things and you press a button and I think, what's it done now? But that's how we communicate, you know, so there's lots of ways. There's WhatsApp, there's text, and that's how we can spread news. But sometimes we have lost the knack to speak to real people. And I think during lockdown, we were really grateful for all these different ways that we had technology. But we missed the extra chat. And in the Bible, communication was difficult as well. And people passed on news by listening to one another, and then they spread it from word of mouth. But how can we spread the good news of Jesus? And Jesus's message is all about love. We're going to think on the marks of mission, and it's about love and how we spread some love. So next slide, please. Can we read that? Probably not. But it's how we help one another by showing God's love. That, oh, great, see, modern technology. You just make it bigger. Who's helped with washing the dishes? Oh, no hands going up. Well, there's your task for this afternoon. Helping with the dishes. I think there was one hand there that said something about shoveling snow. We haven't had an awful lot of snow, but there you are. You can help shovel. Doing things for other people, just little things, makes a big deal. And I think the last slide is, and it came out a book, and it was Axel and his little sister Finlay eat the breakfast together. And this morning, like every other morning, they say the Jesus Creed. And it's the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and love other people as yourself. And I think that's a really nice way to start the day, isn't it? To love other people as we love ourselves. And that's what Jesus asked us to do. And so before we have a prayer, we have something special to do. And I'm going to ask Esther to leave the Zoom room and come from Zoom, out of the ether, all the way down into the church. Do you think she'll manage that? Yeah. So Esther, on behalf of the congregation, we would like to say all the best in your new venture, because for those of you that don't know, Esther is going to start Teachers Training College tomorrow. So we have gathered up a few bits and pieces to say all the best, and we wish you well in your new venture. You will be great. So I have sanitized my hands before. We also have a gift for Catherine, who is moving to Orkney. She's studying archaeology, and last year, obviously, you couldn't move around the country, but this year she's going off to Orkney, so we do have some gifts for her to say that we're thinking about her and praying for both Esther and Catherine on their ventures to Orkney and to Teachers Training College. Thank you. And now, before we sing our sort of children's hymn, it's not really a children's hymn, it's a hymn I like, we'll have a little prayer before Sunday school leave us. Let us pray. Loving God, we give thanks that we can share together today in the sanctuary. And we give thanks for our Sunday school, for our Sunday school teacher, for everybody who spreads the good news of Jesus, his love, to those that we meet. And we just ask the Sunday school that when they go through to their class, that they will enjoy sharing fellowship together for the first time in a long time. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to sing from CH4 771, If You Believe and I Believe. We can stand and sing. So enjoy whatever the teachers have in store for you. We'll hear all about it later. And now let us draw near to God in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, you are the one who created our world and all that it contains. You know each detail of its life. You know each one of your creatures inside out. You gave us the greatest gifts of Jesus as Saviour and your Holy Spirit to empower us. You call us to be witnesses to the love of Jesus and power of your Spirit to change our world and the lives of its people. You have called us to tell the news and make known what you have done for us. You do not simply call others, exempting us from responsibility. giving us the option of leaving it to someone else. You call us all, without exception, to go forth and tell. Loving God, we have heard and received the good news. Save us from keeping it to ourselves. Forgive us for all the times we have done just that, all the occasions we have missed the opportunity to speak out. Forgive us that we are not as excited as we should be by the news we have to share, that having become too familiar with the gospel, too comfortable and complacent, concerned only with ourselves rather than other people. Forgive us for all those who have never heard because we have never told. Loving God, we have heard and received the good news. Save us from keeping it to ourselves. Calling and sending God, help us to recognize afresh all we have to share and make us ready to see those moments which cry out to us to share it. Fill our hearts again with the good news of Christ. May its message again stir our hearts and capture our imaginations, breaking through our apathy, carelessness and indifference. Loving God, we have heard and received the good news. Save us from keeping it to ourselves as we pray in Jesus' name and in his word say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our reading this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 to 4, and Mark 1, verses 1 to 8. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. And now in Mark, we hear as John the Baptist prepares the way. The beginning of the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight paths for him. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothes made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message. After me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandal I am not worthy to stoop and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. And may God add his blessing to this reading of his holy word. Amen. And we're now going to sing On Jordan's Bank, the Baptist Cry, and it's hymn 334. And there is quite a bit of an introduction into this one, but we will sing On Jordan's Bank, the Baptist Cry.
Thank you.
Today we are beginning a series of thinking about the marks of mission, and there are five of them that the Church of Scotland have identified. So we're going to look at the first one this morning, and that is tell the good news of Jesus. So the five marks of mission, as described by the Theological Forum of the Church of Scotland in the report, which is dated May 2020, here are the five that they have identified. To proclaim the good news of the kingdom, to teach, baptize, and nurture new believers, to respond to human need by loving service, to transform unjust structures of society, to challenge violence of every kind and pursue peace and reconciliation, and to strive to safeguard the integrity of creation and sustain and renew the life of the earth. The report is on the Church of Scotland website. If you want to look at it, it's not too bad a document to read, so do have a wee look at it. You're going to hear quite a bit about the five marks of mission over the next few weeks. But there are questions raised by these five marks. As a vision statement for mission, is there a hierarchy within the five marks? Is one or more foundational? Are some more important than others? At least two could be seen as foundational. Arguably, the first mark, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, could be seen as incorporating all of the succeeding elements, particularly if proclamation is understood not only as speaking and writing, but in loving and acting. Alternatively, the third mark, responding to human need by a loving service, could be seen as incorporating proclamation of the gospel, nurturing and baptizing, social and ecological engagement. But more important than any hierarchy is the Forum's conviction that all these five aspects belong within any vision statement of Christian mission. They hang together. Proclaiming the good news of the kingdom necessarily involves transformation in the lives of individuals and societies. Loving service does not stop with care for individuals, but aims to reach the community and the environment. Good news is not only for the salvation of individual people, but for their lived experiences within families and communities, conflicts and creation. In being invited to share God's mission for the world, we are called to contribute across the whole mission so far as we are able. Mission is a word we are going to hear a lot about in the coming months as we focus our minds on where do we stand as a congregation when it comes to mission. What do we mean when we talk about mission? How are we missional as a congregation in our local community? Today's theme is focusing on to proclaim the good news of the kingdom. So hearing good news, the immediate response is to share it with others. A new baby in the family. What happens? The new father is usually dispatched to spread the good news to family and friends who are eagerly waiting to hear that both mother and baby are well. And then the next question is, how much does the baby weigh? And when I weigh in kilos, it doesn't mean an awful lot. And it's quite nice when folks say, can you just turn that into pounds? And I think we weigh babies in pounds, and it means more sense to see a baby weigh 7 pounds than 3 kilos. When a couple get engaged and then make wedding plans, there's great excitement and congratulations, or a new job, or as we've celebrated today with Esther and Catherine going on their new venture, one to Orkney, one to teachers training. So it is great excitement, and we want to share in the joy that spreading the good news brings. In the Old Testament prophet Isaiah had been given good news to share. In the period after the Jews returned from exile in Babylon, they needed good news. Isaiah was called to bring good news to the poor, heal the brokenhearted, release the captives, and freedom from imprisonment. all signs of God saving his people and defeating his enemies, even rebuilding cities that had fallen into ruin. There were visible signs of new life. Isaiah was given news to pass on, to help others get ready and get excited about changing times, personal and communal. News was a reminder that God was with them, loved them, wanted to comfort them. I wonder how often just now we associate news with bad news rather than good. We switch on the TV and we say, oh, there's never any good news on this. Most remember Isaiah's call to be a prophet. It was a dramatic event. It was called Isaiah's commission, and you can find it in chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with 6 wings. With 2 wings they covered their faces, with 2 they covered their feet, and with 2 they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am. Send me." There are many examples in the Bible of God choosing and equipping through the Holy Spirit a variety of people to tell his story and give the good news. John the Baptist was a strange character, but he was chosen and equipped by God for a key role. He was chosen to prepare the way for Jesus. The first words of Mark, "This is the good news about Jesus, the Son of God." And this connects the message with the prophets of old with Jesus and introduces John as the messenger. John's message of repentance and preparation was for what was going to happen next. Perhaps intriguing news for people of his day. What was going to happen? Jews had been waiting 300 odd years for a sign of God coming to intervene. Times of uncertainty, changes in behaviour and attitudes. But people were willing to listen and no doubt go and share news and experiences with others. News spread about John the Baptist. And if we think back to the 50s, the 60s and the 70s, we had rallies from big evangelists, mainly sort of from America. We remember Billy Graham in the 50s. And Billy Graham once said, "I just keep preaching the gospel because there's nothing coming out of Washington or any of those places that are going to save the world, are going to transform men and women. It's Christ." It was Christ that was going to transform. And I remember going to rallies, and I can even remember one being held in the public park in Cowdenbeath of all places and seeing the tent full. Another in Glasgow, going with some of the churches in Cowdenbeath to hear Louis Palau. And the bus driver got us lost on the way back. And we thought, we're never going to make it for Sunday service in the morning. As we're reaching 2 o'clock in the morning and somebody says, "Well, there's the Sunday papers going past." But we did eventually make it back from Glasgow to Fife. And there was summer mission. Many of you remember the summer missions that were held at seaside resorts in, I think, the 80s, because I can remember colleagues from St. Combs when I was there going. but times change. The importance of spreading the good news of Jesus also had effects on local societies when they were visited by these men in the days of these big rallies, and people turned to God in huge numbers then. And it was when statistics were looked at, they found that there was debts were maybe paid quicker, there was less gambling, and people's behaviour changed, all because they were sharing the story of God's love for the world. Times have changed, and as we saw how the telephone has evolved down through the ages, we also need to change how we share the message. The message is the same, but delivery has to reach communities in a meaningful way. The way the church responds has also changed. Missionaries of old went out to other lands to convert the local people to their beliefs and did not always take account of the culture of the country they were in. But today's overseas mission is done in partnership, and both parties gain from each other. It's about sharing the good news of Jesus. We may not feel we are able to stand up in front of crowds to talk about our faith and beliefs, but we're not being asked to do that. God calls us into lives he's given us to share our own story with people we meet. We don't need to be highly educated or eloquent. We have learned a lot about each other, though, during lockdown when we've shared things on Zoom. We've had social events, and over the years we've had study groups, and we've all shared parts of ourselves that we felt comfortable to do. And there are some amazing stories that talk of faith and the ways we have met Jesus in good and bad times. The time now is to tell that story and how it fits with the story of Jesus. The church needs every one of us to take part, not just the ministers or elders or the employees of the church. We come to church to be equipped to go forth and tell. And when we do that with passion and integrity, it will attract others to start exploring how a life of faith can literally change lives and the world. When we look at the state of the world we live in, Christ's message has never been more important. Martin Luther King Jr., American civil rights leader, said, "Jesus was an extremist for love, truth, and goodness." How often do we think of his extremists as a bad influence, like the tragedy we see unfolding in Afghanistan? So the phrase from Martin Luther King resonated with me. Jesus was so passionate about his message, he could today be classed as an extremist. But what a message to be guilty of being extreme about. Love, truth, and goodness. What more needs to be said? Let the message we take away today is that we are all equipped to share Jesus' message of love, truth, and goodness with those we meet. Amen. And so now we come to our intimations. And I think there are some on the screen, but the first one, I'm just going to reiterate that the distance is now 1 meter, so no need to book. But the bit I did forget was we still have a one-way system, so you still have to come in either from the car park or from the Brucefield entrance, and we'll leave by the main church door. We've got the big read, which starts on Wednesday the 8th. It's being run by Gillespie. And I think you could order books. I think I might even have had a bit more detail here. Starts Wednesday the 8th. There are two options. You can go in person to Gillespie at 2 o'clock or on Zoom at 7:30. You can order books. I think some of you might have spoken to Fiona already about this. and unordered books, but I think it will be good, and it's nice to join with other churches in sharing together and learning a bit more about God and the Bible and other messages. Our next one is the Sunday School, and they are urgently asking for help for volunteers. It is great to have the Sunday School back, but they could do with some more teachers, just some people who could help. The teachers will prepare the lessons, but they are looking for a pool of people to help with the rota. So it wouldn't be a huge commitment. Alison and Lynn are providing the materials, and so I'll let you scroll through that. but if you're able to help, you can contact Lynn, Fiona, or Sheila, and Alison's email. But just ask anybody, because the Sunday School is such a great, it's a great opportunity to work with young people. And they are such fun, and we learn so much from them. So please do offer your support as a helper in the Sunday School. And I think that is all the intimations. I'm getting a nod. So I am going to bring up our offering. Let us draw near to God in prayer. Loving God, as you called so many in the past, you call us to be your body on earth. We bring our gifts of time, money, talents to you today in response to your goodness to us, and in the hope that with your blessing, they will be used to tell the good news of Jesus to the world. Amen. We are going to have a prayer for Afghanistan. The Reverend Dr. Marjorie McLean, convener of the Committee on Chaplains to Her Majesty's Forces, has written a prayer for Afghanistan as we remember the suffering of the people of that land and the sacrifices of our military personnel. And I don't think anybody could not be moved by the scenes we've seen on the television over this last week. So let us draw close to God as we pray for Afghanistan. All loving God, your hands have fashioned every lovely corner of this treasured planet, and the beautiful land of Afghanistan is as precious as every other place your children call home. By its rivers and mountains, its fields and gardens, its busy towns and ancient villages, it is the heart's desire of its people, and the place where they live, their lives and loves are nurtured. We grieve today with those who grieve over Afghanistan, the people who call it home indeed, the people exiled or suddenly have to leave, and the men and women from other countries who have made sacrifices in recent years in the cause of that country's future. We remember with renewed sadness the loss of lives of military personnel during the years of this country's involvement in Afghanistan, conscious of the questions that must today be troubling the minds of those in our community who are bereaved, those who were wounded on operations, and those who were forever changed by experiences suffered there. We pray for peace, dignity, freedom, and confidence for the men, women, and children of Afghanistan, for courage, vision, and generosity within the international community responding to such need, and for the tranquility of mind amongst our own service community and its wider family. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Peace Giver, we pray. Amen. And now let us bring our own prayers for the world before God. Let us pray. We pray for all who are teaching and training others to share the gospel in universities and colleges, in congregations, in the workplace, and we remember all who are working to devise new courses and ways of communication that will enable all Christians to deepen their faith and to share in a variety of ways. Give them insight, energy, and enthusiasm to teach and encourage others to tell your good news. We pray for all who are learning, from children and teens to adults of all ages. Help them to have open minds and hearts to hear your voice speaking through others. We pray especially for our own members who we know are in hospital or are ill, who are recovering from surgery and other illnesses. We just bring them before you and ask that you lay your healing hand upon them. And in a time of silent prayer, we bring before all those we know. Lord, we pray for our world, for healing, physical, mental, and spiritual, so that your news of peace, love, joy, and hope will change lives today and every day. As we pray in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. And our final hymn this morning that we will sing is Sent by the Lord Am I, and it's 250 from CH4. Sent by the Lord Am I. That was quite fast, that, wasn't it? Try and catch up with the words, but we'll get there. So we're going to close with the Marketon blessing once more. So do feel free to sign and sing as you are able.
Be gracious to you, the Lord's hand.